Hi everyone, it's Jenny Dang. I'm currently in Sonoma County. For dinner tonight, we're having SingleThread. Let's see if it's worth the travel.
Beverage, get you two settled in. This is a warm local gravocene apple cider mixed with some rosemary grown on our roof. Enjoy.
A lot of what you're seeing here is your first course, but also a look into our farm that sits over on Dry Creek Road. So we have a 24-acre property, and we use about a third of it to cultivate the menu that you'll see tonight. And as you can tell, a little Japanese influence that comes into the cuisine, as both Kyle and Katina spent 10 years in Hokkaido, Japan. Kushi oysters. So they're finished with a little segment of kiwi coming from Santa Cruz. The oysters are a really nice palate cleanser as well, so I do suggest to start with that one. So you have a panna cotta of chestnut. This is also topped with Siberian sturgeon caviar. Shima aji, which is a style of striped jack. This also has a nori puree that's finished with that bite as well. A5 Wagyu. This is done into a tartlet that's finished with little mustard greens sitting over the top. You can also feel free to pick that one straight up. Bluefin tuna. This is coming from Baja, Mexico. In the center of that is a little blend of Buddha's hands, and then there's also mioga sitting at the bottom of that plate as well. Hokkaido scallop. This is finished with habanada pepper, so same family as habanero, but the nada means there's no heat to go along with it. And then goma tofu. So if you are a fan of peanut butter, this kind of takes on a similar texture. It's a tofu that's made from sesame, also has nori and fresh wasabi sitting over it.
Sashimi of grilled sawara, also known as the Spanish mackerel. And under it, you're gonna find oven roasted queens and broccoli coming from our farm, a little bit of pomegranate seeds, and a daikon salad. To finish off, the chef pour a queen sponge that will really bring some nice umami flavors to the dish. Santa Barbara. And at the very bottom of the shell, you're gonna find a traditional Japanese shawamushi, followed by a sea lettuce cream. Slices of celtus, a pan-seared abalone, and next to that, sea urchin that is also coming from Santa Barbara, but in this case, this one was torched. You're gonna find this nice and smoky flavor. Right at the top, a combination of shingiku and Iceland coming from our farm. And to finish off, a touch of fried tall sea lettuce. I'd just like to mention on this one that only what is inside of the shell is edible.
Thank you.
So an ingredient we grow throughout the year at the farm, which are Salanova lettuces. These are accompanied by little nasturtiums, mizunas, and mustard greens. And as you move into the dish, there's a blend of badger flame beets. These beets can actually be consumed raw. They were cultivated that way by row 7 seeds, so you can pick it up like just an apple. At the bottom of the dish, you have a duck liver parfait that also has an incorporation of turnip and meat as well. So as you go through this dish, just get your fork down to the bottom and go into it. Tile fish that also can have its scales left on because they're so soft and delicate in texture. So as the kitchen's preparing this dish, they are taking the hot oil and continuously running that over the top of the scales. They then start to flake up and create this beautiful chicharron-like texture. To go along with that, we're using the bones from the fish as we try to take everything full circle and incorporating it into a dashi that sits at the bottom. There's also a blend of cabbages and pumpkins coming from the farm, and that forms a little pumpkin mochi that sits to the side. It's also wrapped in sesame as well. As you go through the main components of this dish, I definitely suggest at the end, pick it up and feel free to enjoy it.
Featuring the Kyoto red carrot, which we also have presented in the basket. Inside the jar is your course, and feel free to take it out from the centerpiece and bring it toward you. There are many layers to this. First, you're seeing the Kyoto red itself, and then the carrot top granita, followed by what you're not able to see, a pesto made of carrots for the savory component, an almond dukkah, and a frozen carrot marshmallow sorbet. Spoon all the way down, all the way up, get everything in one bite.
Wagyu beef coming from the Miyazaki Prefecture in Japan, and all that the chefs did is they took the ribeye and they sear it on the heart. Next to that, a beef stew reduction, and alongside these, two different preparations with kohlrabi coming from our farm. One poached in a seasoned dashi and filled with an herb puree, and next to that one, a kohlrabi cream. A little bit of olive oil from our friends at Preston Winery, chewy apples, and to finish up right on the center, the cherry on top of the cake, black truffles coming from Burgundy in France.
Both of them have been together since high school, and during that time, we spent about 10 years in the Japan. So a lot of the decor that surrounds you and also the dishes that you see implement some of that Japanese culture and within this course as well are a few items that are meant to be shared. And I'm going to start on this side.
Bluefin tuna. This is coming from Baja, Mexico. Earlier in the year, we did a little collaboration here with Ethanol, and we actually brought this tuna with them to use within the menu. One of the main conversations we had
these are souffle buns, so they come out of the larger delicious family of food like Yorkshire puddings. Batter goes into oil, magic happens, right? And this is going to be a warm, crispy bun filled with an apple butter. So
coming your way next is a very special item to Northern California. We tend, as soon as the rain season starts, to get plethoras of mushrooms. The world would probably hope to have the same ability to have the mushrooms that we have locally here. And Marley and Kyle wanted to put a dish together that was going to incorporate many of those different abundances. So you have a few mushrooms that are actually grown indoors, and then a lot of wildly foraged as well. So we have the maitake mushrooms, you also have king trumpet and black trumpet mushrooms. The chanterelles always get that beautiful look because of that golden brown hue to go along with it, and then beach mushrooms as well. One of the things that really brings out in this dish is that beautiful umami, but we're getting the shunmai rice in now too, the koshiakari style, so it's the first growths of the beginning of the rice season. And this is very heavily celebrated in Japanese culture because it's a bright vibrance to the rice. So as we go through this dish that's about to come your way, it's going to be a little blend of both of those components, and I'll be back with the rest momentarily.
For the last savory course this evening, we're following traditional Kaisaki cuisine. Shima rice means a new crop of rice or new rice. So this rice is super interesting as the water content is a little higher. So contradictory to what we usually would see on rice cooking where it's equal parts of water and rice. In this case, it's less water than the amount of rice. And what you're gonna find with this entire content is gonna be a creamier texture, sort of touching on the risotto territory. And as you saw, all of these different mushrooms, that half of them are forage, and all the other ones are coming from Mycopia in Sebastopol that are farm raised. Cook individually every single type of them. Some of them are oven roasted, grilled in the heart, and also seasoned, dashi, poached. Over here, where you're gonna find at the very bottom of the plate, this duck tsukune. And traditionally in Japan, the tsukune is chicken noodle, but in this case, as we work with our friends at Ross Family Farms from the Nice Valley, we have this lovely duck that we utilize. So you're gonna find a mixture of Sancho pepper and the duck over there. And follow on the top all the different mushrooms and the seasoned dashi that will bring you some really great umami flavors.
Thank you. And then to finish off in the center of the table are chouquettes, kind of traditional French pastry buns that would fill with a spiced pear cream. And I do recommend starting with those buns in the center. Those are a bit warm and you don't want those to cool up too much. So this dessert here is utilizing some of the personal fruits that we saw at our farm for the season, which are pears, being locally sourced from the front of our farm. Starting at the very bottom, there is a funivert collar that's been filled with a fall spice chiffon cake, and then being poured over it here is a pear consomme. The orange surrounding it all is a custard mousse that's been filled with a pear sorbet, and at the very base of it, a burnt oak praline.
Final bites of the evening here for you. And I'll start with the tea that sits between the two of you. It's a blend of geranium and mint. We actually grow it on our rooftop garden. It's just a nice sipper to go along with this course. Just beside it, a custard of passion fruit. There's also an incorporation of miso with that. That's what the spoons are meant for as well. And then you have a tartlet of Okinawa black sugar done as a mousse over the top, and then ume, which is a Japanese hybrid of apricot and plum, to finish everything off here for you. Below, a cheesecake that's Japanese style, so it's steamed. There's also a little dollop of yuzu sitting over the top of it.
Thank you, SingleThread, for the wonderful meal. Now it's time for my rating to see if it's worth the travel. First of all, I absolutely love their concept of farm to table, and they definitely have no trouble showing it. Immediately, I was blown away by the presentation and taste of the first bites. They clearly show the work they put into their farm all the way to their kitchen. However, when the meal continues, I find myself loving some courses and underwhelmed by some. So for the food, it's a 4. For their tasting menu, it's $425, making it a 1.75 for the price. All the staffs are very professional and proper. They explained every course with such detail and grace. The drinks were never empty, and my napkin was always folded after returning to my seat. I especially love how the whole kitchen staff will pause to take a quick picture with you, no matter how busy they are. The service is a 5 out of 5. The restaurant is located in Healdsburg, where it's a fantastic place to wind down and enjoy some sips at wineries or visit beautiful vineyards. So it's a 5 for the location. The overall rating is 3.94, which makes it worth local travel. So if you stay in California, SingleThread is 100% worth the visit. However, do keep in mind that it's only 0.06 points away from domestic travel. For reservations, they open weekly each Thursday at 9 a.m. Pacific time for the following 5 weeks out. For example, on February 1st, you'll be able to book the dates March 1st to March 7th. Good luck with your reservation. Thank you so much for watching. See you in the next video.